Dr. Wichter isn't the type to sugarcoat things, like when it comes to brain deterioration as you age.
As a baby, this brain is completely smooth and it gets more and more wrinkly, like our faces, as we get older.
He will also tell you that aging brains are far more susceptible to stroke.
A stroke is very similar to a heart attack. Heart attacks are blocked arteries in the heart. Strokes are blocked arteries in the brain. These are arteries going to the left side of the brain, the middle of the brain.
The one big difference he sees between a heart attack and a stroke is the way we generally react to them.
People understand if you have crushing chest pain, you better get to a hospital pretty quickly. But somehow if somebody wakes up after a nap and their right side is weak and they have trouble with slurred speech, they go back and take a nap. Well, that's the worst thing you can do.
But unfortunately, going to sleep is exactly what Michael Angelakos did.
I felt a little burst in the back of my head, around my neck area. But then I saw I couldn't write, so I said, this is not good. So I went and lied down, and I felt my leg jumping. Something was wrong, but I didn't know what symptoms to look for. By the morning, I was completely paralyzed.
One simple way to recognize a stroke is by using the acronym FAST.
F-A-S-T. It stands for face, meaning a facial droop, arm weakness or problems using an arm, speech slurring or inability to get the words to the mouth, and one of the most important and ignored is the T.
The T is for time.
Get to a hospital quickly, and second of all, note what time the event happened.
But long before stroke sets in, the signs are often already there. And Michael had most of them.
He's a time bomb. I mean, he's a stroke waiting to happen. He's a heart attack waiting to happen. High blood pressure is probably number one. High cholesterol, lipids. Inactivity, obesity, poor diabetic control, alcohol, and smoking.
Michael, being a diabetic smoker with a history of heart issues, didn't help. But there was one more problem. A big one.
Most importantly, and this is probably one of the most important messages going forward, is he wasn't taking his medication.
I didn't believe in him, like a lot of people.
But since his stroke, he's really changed his tune. All it took was a little tough love from his doc.
Take your meds. You gotta take your meds. End the story.
Taking medicine that's prescribed to you daily is absolutely the only way you're gonna prevent stroke.
And this deviation from a prescription plan is an issue pharmacists see regularly with older adults.
If there are heart conditions, if patients have diabetes, there are some medications like anticoagulants that we use that help prevent stroke. If those are missed on a regular basis, they can worsen and can predispose patients to what we're protecting them from.
But why is this such an issue, and what can we do? I sat down for a chat with pharmacy director Rola Swice to find out.
You know, management of your prescriptions can be tough for anybody, but certainly for older adults having trouble managing those prescriptions. Why is that?
Older adults are a little bit more susceptible just because of the vast number of medications they tend to be on. So the number just in its own can cause confusion. One of the reasons patients end up with so many prescriptions is because they go to multiple physicians. And many times patients, when I see them, they really get upset if they walk out of an office or an emergency department and they don't have a prescription. So you don't always need a prescription for everything. They might have a list of 15 medications and we can easily eliminate 5 or 6.
So older adults have a tendency to be taking more medication for various reasons. Is it important for them to even know what pill goes for what and what's it affecting on their body?
It's very, very key for patients to really understand what their medications are for. Whether it's when they're picking up their prescriptions at the pharmacy or when they're seeing their provider, is making sure they are asking questions to understand what their medications are for, what the side effects are.
Maybe take a picture of it or, you know, kind of draw out a diagram for them. So when they're taking their pills in the morning or at night, they can go, okay, I remember that this blue one is for my heart disease.
Absolutely. Anything that can help the patient with remembering and when to take what is appropriate. So calendars work very well.
How important, though, was it for the doctor or the physician to see that list?
Very important, because they may have to make adjustments. They may discontinue a medication, especially if it's a duplicate. The other reason, many times when patients are seeing their physicians, they may say, oh, well, why are you on this medication? And that will trigger them to say, oh, well, I was diagnosed with this.
And on the medication list, it's the list and the dosage and when they take it.
Absolutely.
Down to everything, to that baby aspirin that you take at night, even write that, and your vitamin C.
Absolutely, because many vitamins can actually interact with certain medications, and they may need to be separated by a couple of hours.
So three takeaways, not only for the patient, but for the caregiver, would be?
Manage your list, know what your medications are all about and why you're taking them, and ensure you keep up with your appointments, because many times medications require certain lab tests and monitoring.
Perfect, thank you so much. Yeah.